Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I am Dr. Muhyiddin Mirza, your host for the program Food for Thought. We also called it in a few programs Thought for Food because that's the subject we have been talking about, that what does involve in food planning, food eating. And we were very fortunate to have Qasim Islam Saab with in the previous program. We are going to have him again on this program. But just to recap, what we had talked before was that the food is the most important part of living. We of course eat food to take benefit out of it. Of course, Islamic teachings are there as well, where the food has to be halal and tayyib, that is allowed by the law, and pure and wholesome. You'll be amazed to when you learn that under the word tayyib, so many aspects of food are covered, that wholesome, nutritious, free of bacteria, free of toxin, all those things fit into that. So this program, inshallah, is going to focus on food labeling and ingredients, what to make sense out of them. Actually, they become so confusing sometime that when you read the label, so if says it contains this, so what does it mean? So I'm going to talk to Qasim Islam Saab again. Sir, welcome again. It's good
Thank
to
you.
See you. That
Thank you.
You look happy and healthy and eating good.
Yeah, you have to.
Right. So I know with our viewers, we have talked a lot about foods in general.
Right.
So today we are going to focus, inshallah, on food labeling.
Right.
So when did this, in the Western society, when did this labeling start?
Again, you know, labeling has become a science at this point of time.
Right.
And right now we are talking about in developed countries.
Right.
They have spent a lot of time and effort to actually get into a place. Like every single company has a dedicated person who is actually doing this job.
Right.
It's almost now 2 decades now that, you know, people got into it. Why they got into it? Because the malnutrition and the ingredients and all those things actually led them to define, okay, fine, what gonna go in the food? Every industry or every manufacturer who is making a product has to define what is going in the product.
Right.
Because
right.
these are now, everything is processed. Processing has been now actually the time of the need of the time.
Right.
Because you can have fresh food all the time, especially people are now traveling more, they need. Right. So when the processing industry and further food processing industry evolved, the need of labeling and the right labeling with the right ingredients actually come alive.
You brought a very good point that even food processing, well, some aspect have been known to civilization for a long time.
You're right.
Simple sun drying, for example.
Very right.
The fish.
Pickling, and they didn't know that adding salt, what happening.
Exactly. Yeah.
But now they believe that because they are actually limiting all those factors which microorganisms need.
Right.
Microorganisms are living beings.
Right. Right.
It's like us. They just are micro.
Yeah. Yeah.
They need food.
Yeah.
They need oxygen.
Right.
They need water.
Right.
So whatever they used to do, like drying meat or drying food in sun, actually reducing water.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So then, you know, you have food actually for extended shelf life.
Right.
So you're right. Like it's actually been known, but they didn't know why. But they have been doing it for a longer period of time.
So the you have mentioned the need for food processing has been to make food available out of season.
Yes.
Normally in human civilization, we used to eat probably whatever you got today is by hunting some vegetable, what nature was growing. Some things are remarkable which trigger your mind. The story of Prophet Yunus, Yunus al-Islam.
Right.
When you, it comes in the media once in a while, in different reason, different context,
right.
that when he was thrown out of the valley of the Baal,
right.
A bird dropped a seed there, and it was a very fast growing pumpkin seed. That's what I guess.
Right.
And that pumpkin became the source of the food for there. So he must have been eating that pumpkin for quite a bit period of time.
Yeah.
By probably sun drying as well.
I think if you look into the history, human being didn't know, but eventually he got, okay, that's the reason, that's why it happened. And then we started thinking, okay, fine, what was the reason that specific incident happened? And pretty much like its history is full of those kind of examples that then we started learning, you know what, this is the, like, somehow somebody knew that they're like, somebody, you know, in history, we read it that they forgot the milk outside.
Right.
The next morning, the milk was curd.
Right.
And then they realized why and how. They tasted it.
Right, right.
And then it tastes a little bit better.
Yeah.
It was good for the stomach.
Yeah.
And then they realized there is something going in.
Exactly.
That actually rotten milk can be taken as well.
Right. So food processing has been known to mankind, but the food process which we are talking about now is relatively recent.
Maybe it is.
50 years or something like
yeah.
that. But what I'm finding is that there are different types of process which are involved. I don't see much processing of fresh fruit, for example.
Right.
Although dried fruit was available. But tell us a little bit about what sort of techniques you, for example, we talked about dehydration.
Right.
You cut up something, but I have seen that things being mixed together, quite a bit of things together, and they're adding different chemicals and preservative. So
right.
Well, what are the most of the common technique beside canning, for example, powder?
If you look at, like, there are two different ways of preserving food.
Right, okay.
One is making sure that do all those things possible
right.
to keep that bacteria and those microorganisms
right.
away.
Right.
And the other way is that, okay, fine, that use those procedures or use chemicals.
And you make new products as well.
Yes. So two different approaches. One, that you actually use some procedures to avoid right. those microorganisms
right.
to grow and get
right.
into it.
Right.
Another is use chemicals. If you look at pasteurization,
mm-hmm.
look at sterilization.
Okay, that's good. So pasteurization.
Right.
What's pasteurization?
Pasteurization usually is done mostly for milk.
Milk, okay.
But now even pasteurized juices are coming.
Okay. So but pasteurized is different than sterilization?
It is. Pasteurization is actually heating a product to 170 to 175 degree Celsius.
No, Fahrenheit. That's Celsius.
It's a Fahrenheit. No, it's Celsius.
Celsius. Okay.
You really take the temperature
okay,
a little bit high
right.
for 15 minutes.
Okay. I see.
And then now you have HTST as well.
Mm-hmm.
High temperature, short time.
Hold on.
HTST. High temperature, short time.
Okay.
So actually temperature goes beyond 200
right.
for the flash of a second.
Okay.
And that kills most of the microorganisms.
Okay. And that's called pasteurization.
That's another treatment.
Okay.
And then the next stage is ultra-high treatment. Like
mm-hmm.
ultra-high means it's very high temperature.
Right.
And then you really give a little bit of time. And it kills the microorganisms.
Right.
It doesn't denature the casein, that's
right.
milk protein.
Right.
But pasteurization is actually the common practice. We usually get the milk that
yeah.
is pasteurized.
I don't know in your generation, but when I was growing up, my favorite was the milk from the buffalo. Water buffalo, and at the end, after it has been taken out, now you know the warm
there you go, yeah.
feeling. I know right now some people tell that it could be bacteria there, but I know mom was very aware of the hygiene, so
right.
It was
and
clean,
clean
and
yeah.
then this is how we are brought up. But
milk is actually said that it's the best food, but the worst food as well. Is the best food in terms
mm-hmm.
that it contains carbohydrates,
right.
it contains proteins,
fruit, yeah.
it contains fats, minerals, vitamins, you name it, everything is in it.
Mm.
Now, worse food is
mm.
that if you don't treat it well,
right.
milk can be easily spoiled
yeah.
within hours,
really,
minutes,
so fast. Mm.
If it's left at room temperature.
Mm.
This is a danger zone.
Right.
And the danger zone is called, like, we should really make sure that even in our homes,
right.
your fridge is working right.
Yeah.
You're not leaving milk outside the room temperature.
Right.
So the danger zone is
mm-hmm.
that in that temperature range,
right.
those dangerous bacteria start growing.
Right, right.
So you have to make sure that keep product under 4 degrees Celsius
right, right.
or to 40 degrees Celsius. So 4 to 40
right,
Celsius.
Right. Yeah.
So making sure that either warm it well,
right?
Like the way we
yeah,
heat,
yeah, right,
the, you
yeah,
know,
yeah.
warm the milk, or yeah. keep it in the refrigerator.
So while we're talking of milk, the processing of milk was known for quite a bit of time. I know when we were growing up, of course, the milk was heated right away.
Yeah.
And then you process into malai, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
What's the
yeah.
English?
The fat usually
the
comes
fat
on top
comes
of it, right?
Of it.
The cream.
And then the rest of the milk with all the calcium and other thing becomes you put some jog or yogurt in
yeah.
and then that become a source of.
You're very right. And
yeah.
right now we're doing the same, like industry is doing the same concept.
Right, right.
So what they do is they heat, they pasteurize the milk,
right.
sometimes they skim it.
Right.
Skimming is the same thing. You're taking malai out, they're
right.
taking cream on
right.
from the top.
Right.
Now the milk left is actually low in fats,
right.
low
okay.
in cream.
Right.
And then we used to use that leftover yogurt
yeah.
from yesterday
right.
to inoculate it.
Inoculate it.
Right now people are using inoculation by microorganism. You have synthetic in capsules, in powder, or they still can use the same method. And these are called as set yogurt. That actually you actually pour the milk, you let it cool, and then you inoculate it, then you incubate it. Incubation is the same thing, because bacteria need certain temperature to grow.
Absolutely.
And then you incubate them, and that's the way it is.
Well, we'll talk more on this one. So processing, you mentioned that the liquids and juices, pasteurization, sterilization.
And we talked about high temperature
short duration.
And right now, I have a great example. Even fermentation is another very good product.
Right.
Fermented products are actually known to be better for stomach, because microorganisms actually degrade those complex molecules, and it's easily assimilated. Sauerkraut is a perfect example. People used to it's old time product. They used to chop cabbage.
Sauerkraut.
Sauerkraut.
Okay. Right. Yeah.
So they
yeah.
chop salt on it.
Right.
Then press it.
Right.
And then cover it and leave it outside.
Yeah. Fermentation.
Fermentation.
Yeah.
And that's, pizza is a perfect example of fermentation.
Right, right.
And bread is a perfect example of fermentation.
Right,
so,
right.
Like, we have tons of product that's been fermented now. So, industry has actually gone into more modern ways and more modern techniques to process food and to extend the shelf life.
Yeah. But in the media, we keep on seeing that processed food, then you lose some minerals, some vitamins, so they add to that.
Enrichment.
And maybe that's the reason the labels came in.
Right.
But more information is provided. Label is more like a general ingredient, but then going into when ingredient, we must also know about it. So when we talk about ingredients of a food product,
right.
And we'll show our audience as well, different products as well, so that they could read it. So our viewers should be aware the label.
Right.
And then the ingredients.
Right.
So we'll pick up some product and go through them one by one so that people could understand that.
Right.
Let's look at the product. Here is a product which came to my attention, and have a look at it.
Right.
Read for us, what is the product?
So it's a macaroni and cheese.
It has most favorite with the kids, I know.
Oh, yeah, because it's easy to make it. The instructions are there that you get it from the store, bring it down, and you add milk and water, you warm it, it's ready.
Right. Yeah. So it is packaged in a paper,
It is a pouch inside. Sometimes it has a pouch inside, or if you open it, sometimes it's just in the box because it's dry.
Right,
so it's usually no moisture, it's safe because, you know, first of all, like if they have, you know, aseptically sealed it and done it properly, not going
to
be a problem.
I'd like you to read the label first, and then we'll go into, for example, what does the label say?
If you allow me to first read the ingredients.
Okay,
or,
all right. Yeah, sure. Yeah. Let's go.
If you look at the ingredients, and it says macaroni modified milk ingredients.
Okay. So it contains macaroni.
And powdered milk or milk derivatives.
So
it's not milk. It's kind of, you know, like maybe a dried milk.
Okay.
And a portion of it.
Right.
So that's the modified milk ingredients, like it still have some part of milk, but some other stuff is added into it.
Okay.
Cheddar cheese solids, and that cheddar cheese solid is made from milk and culture and salt and pepsin and everything.
Right.
And modified corn starch.
Okay.
Salt.
When they say modified, it means it's not the natural starch. They have done something.
They have done something. They are degraded a little bit, that it can be assimilated properly, because starches are very complex molecules.
Right, right.
Sometimes they do like a partial breakdown.
Okay.
That's what they modify it.
Okay.
Disodium phosphate.
Now, what is this? Disodium phosphate.
This is now a chemical, right?
Okay.
It's a phosphate, and then, you know, sodium is the, there's two molecules.
But what
two
does it do? I mean, what does it do?
This is flavor enhancer.
Okay.
And it, but again, we'll talk about the other aspect.
Right, right.
The gums. To make it a little bit thicker.
So it has gums as
gums as well.
Okay.
And then color is tartrazine.
That's a dye?
Yeah, that's a dye. So they actually make the pasta look like yellowish.
To
they have added a color to
it. You. Yeah.
So these are the ingredients. Now, I can bet you on this. Most of our, like, even we, because we kind of know the label, they know the ingredients, but nobody can understand what tartrazine is.
And then how could you make the decision if, for example, my child is sensitive to milk?
Right.
then right away this product is
out. You have to understand what's going in it. Like, there's no need to be too scientific with this.
Yeah.
But at least as a layman, you can easily go through, you know what, if I have allergy with peanuts, and I'm reading right now that peanut oil or maybe a butter peanut or something is there, just avoid it.
Absolutely.
Yep. So now I'll go through that. So there are two things. First of all, before you pick anything off the shelf, make sure know what you need.
The ingredient,
understand the ingredients.
Yeah.
No need to be bored, detailed, but definitely making sure that you know what major ingredients are.
Right, okay.
If we look at the nutrition facts, so this one is...
So this has got, beside ingredients now has a label.
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
So it has the ingredients and now it has all the nutritional information.
Okay, can you read the number one?
So the number one is that per 1x4 package, like 50 gram.
So that's a serving size?
That's what, because the instruction, the 1x4 package is the serving size. So it's a 4-serving pack. Right?
I love to eat all, so actually 4 serving there.
Yeah, it is.
And the facts they have given is for one serving. So 1/4 portion.
1/4 portion gonna give us this much.
So that must be a clever thing to see if the calories are high or something. Actually,
they're never gonna give you the whole package calorie, because otherwise you are looking at somewhere like 600 calories.
Really?
So like, as we already discussed, like it has become so modern. Technique that people spend tons of money to get the nutritional evaluation done.
Exactly. So serving size.
Serving size is that per 1/4 package, all the nutritional ingredients is based on that.
And that'll be how many grams?
It's 50 gram. The total is 200 gram.
So 50 gram is only.
It's 200 gram.
2 ounces roughly.
That's it. 16 grams or that's.
Yeah, 28.
24,
gram,
24. Yeah,
28. 28 gram is 1 ounce.
That's it. So it's kind of 2 ounces.
2 ounces.
And then, of course, they are now asking you to add prepared, some stuff, but we're not going to go through it. We're just going to go through it.
All right.
So the more important thing is that dry mix without preparing it, it has 180 calories.
180.
That's coming only
just
from?
Just in 2 ounces.
2 ounces.
Okay.
Now, those 180 calories, but if you prepare it, because you can add, if you look at the ingredients, it says you add the milk or water, you add a little bit salt, so that's gonna add some more calories on it. So prepared one is actually adding 90 more calories on the dry one.
So
it's actually getting to 270.
So we'd like to talk about calories a little later, but let's go to the label. Next information is what?
Next is the ones which you really want to pay attention that don't add too much in your calories.
Right.
Okay. That's about fats, lipids, saturated fatty acids. So fats.
It says total fat first there?
Yeah. The fats is 1.5 gram. That is, we're going to talk about the grammage first and then we'll talk about the values.
So so it says 1.5 grams.
Gram.
But the total package will be times 4. So that is 6.
For sure.
Okay.
And out of that 1.5
grams. Well, let's read that on the right hand side, there's a percentage daily value as well.
So the daily value means now everybody and every human being is different. Your needs are totally different than mine.
Right.
You need different calories than mine based on what you do, what your age is, what your weight is, what your height is, how much work you're doing during the day, those calorie needs are.
I never think of that, when I'm eating. So the needs vary? I mean,
your calories requirements when you are working?
Like let's say a typical child, can we have a broad guideline, a child from 1 to 7 years old, generally, how many calories?
Because they, at that time, especially teens need more calories.
Okay.
The child, they need lower calories than the teens. And teens are growing. And then of course,
the athletes need probably, I saw 7,000 calories or something.
It depends. Like I was just calculating for a person who is 38 years old, who is 6 feet in height, who weighs 200 pounds and has a moderate activity.
Right.
He needs 4,500 calories per day.
4,500
calories per day. Everyone can calculate it. It's very easy. You go on Google, write down calorie calculator.
Okay.
You put your information in, it's going to give you.
Really? Okay.
This guy is now 6 feet high and 200 pounds, of course, you need more.
Right.
But an ordinary person, like 5 feet, 5 and a half, 150 to 140 pounds. I'm pretty sure 2,000 to 2,500.
So all of us should know, if Google is not available, then is there any rule of thumb or something?
That's just, I mean, like if you are five and a half, you weigh 140 to 150 pounds, your moderate activity have in your life, you need 2,000 to 2,500. And most of these nutritional information is based on 2,000 calories.
Okay, I see. That's what percentage daily value comes in.
Yes.
Based on 2,000 calories.
Yes.
But what are calories? Is it energy?
It's a measuring way. It's a measurement, how we measure energy.
Okay.
And even measuring heat, the same word is used, like measuring heat is a calorie.
Right.
So because food provides us energy, so there is a way to measure it. How much energy is taken from that food? Like fats. 1 gram of fat give you 9 calories.
9 calories.
1 gram of carbohydrates give you 4 calories.
Okay.
1 gram of protein give you 4 calories. So if you're eating
more
100 grams of fat, your daily is 2,000. So half of that you already taken from fats.
So that's what the label they try to give you, that fat will provide 18% of the calories. What's the figure there?
It says 2% is actually coming from dry, but the prepared one going to give you 18% of your total requirement
coming
for that
from
day.
Fat. Under the fat, then
we have saturated
fat
and trans.
So what is a saturated fat?
That's a long chain fatty acids.
Okay.
So
butter will be a saturated fat?
Butter is, but the good thing about butter, I think we talked about the last program, that it has a short chain fatty acids.
Okay.
Butyric acid kind of easily split.
Right.
But the long chain fatty acid, of course, now you're putting too much pressure on your liver and intestine to digest. And
I like the correlation that so liver has to work harder to produce more bile to emulsify.
And what we do in Ramadan, right? Like everybody wants to eat 2 or 3 parathas in the morning because fats takes longer time to get digested. So you feel that you're going to keep your stomach filled for longer time.
Right.
That's what happened because fats is the least that at the end digested.
But on the other hand, body has to work harder to digest those. So would you lose some calories then?
No. People actually put more weight during
because that. Because I saw a company advertising their sandwiches that you actually eat it this way, you will lose weight.
No. Even look at this, what we do at iftar. Now, the whole day, your stomach is empty.
Right.
And then you load it with deep fried pakoras and samosas and all those things. So that's, I think
we really need. Oh, my mouth is already watering. Don't talk about
it. We need to look into that.
Okay.
So if you look at saturated fatty acid and so 0.5 grams.
Okay.
So there's no trans fat coming in here.
And how much percentage?
3% is dry, but 11%.
Really?
Out of that 18%, 11% is coming from saturated fatty acids. So that is actually bad fatty acids.
Yeah, bad fatty acids. Yes.
So you actually getting more than 50% from bad fatty acids.
Right. And then what's the trans fat? What's the?
We talk like it's just, you know, the bonding change.
Okay.
So cis is a good fat and trans is a kind of bad. Everybody right now talking about trans fat that should be zero in the product because the body cannot assimilate it.
Okay.
And what happened with the fat is like when it even get digested,
right,
those smaller fatty acid get absorbed back in the linings of intestine and then they are taken back either with the blood.
Right.
They combine again to make bigger molecules. And that takes to heart. And then
let's go to the arteries.
Yes. Then you have the problem of heart attacks. And extra fat is easily, you know, deposited on your those tissue which you don't really move.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
So that's
our viewers should be aware of this. And I think there's a big push now, zero trans fat in our food
that's
supply.
That's what.
And of course, French fries contain that as well. I think in the media's.
It depends.
Different type of products.
It depends now, like because oil is, especially the frying oil, is a very delicate product.
Right.
If you are, even if you do at home, so if you fry something today, it gets to a boiling point.
Yes. Yeah.
Then it's come to a flash point.
Right.
Then it's come to a fire point.
Yes. Exactly.
So you probably can end up, you know, lighting a fire on your oil.
Yeah. Exactly.
So it's very important to understand when it starts splashing.
Right.
That means that oil has to be changed. But in industry.
Yeah.
Then who cares?
Exactly.
So it's very important, like how much you can avoid deep fried stuff we must avoid it.
Right. So what you're telling our viewer is that watch, now what's the trans fat in this case?
There's no trans fats.
Okay.
But there are saturated fatty acids.
Okay.
They are coming from here. Okay. We have 5 milligram cholesterol.
Okay, here's other thing now. So you yesterday, last time in our program, you said that cholesterol
is actually produced.
Body normally produces cholesterol.
Yeah, but so, mm-hmm. but the problem happens is when it exceeds that threshold,
right.
That's where the problems comes.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the problem
and
comes.
That's becomes with the trans fat and goes into the blood, and that's where those fatty.
And then you have now LDL and HDL. That's yeah. another
yeah.
discussion.
Yeah.
But just as a thumb rule, cholesterol body need. Body need cholesterol.
It produces naturally on
yes.
its own. Yeah.
Because cholesterol help your body to dissolve and digest fats.
Right.
If
right.
there's no cholesterol,
yeah.
it's not gonna, because bile and cholesterol come in together and that actually work as a detergent, break down into simple molecules, and then it's get digested.
Really?
But
yeah.
cholesterol we take in with the food,
mm-hmm.
that actually, you know, change the balance.
Interesting.
So we just need to look into like
yeah.
what we eat.
Yeah. So even cholesterol is not simple. There's a HDL, high density lipids,
yeah,
and LDL.
Yeah, low density and high density.
Really?
Like it has been getting more complicated
yeah.
while science has been working into this more.
Right, right. Dr. Saab, we have to, Qasim Saab, we have to hold this thought for our next program. So we are talking about basically nutrition facts. Thank you very much. We appreciate that.
You're
I'd
welcome.
Love to continue this. A lot of good information is coming out.
Thank you.
Well, this is program Food for Thought, or Thought for Food. We have been talking with Qasim Islam Saab on the subject of reading the labels when you buy from the marketplace, all the food which is processed. Look at the ingredients well. And inshallah, we'll continue more on this subject because it is vital for our health and health of the community in general as well. We want you to be healthy, and that's the whole idea of this program. So this is Food for Thought, Thought for Food. I'm Dr. Mohiuddin Mirza, your host for this program. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.